This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, with all these technical glitches going on, just one last confirmation. Are you guys able to see my screen? Okay, awesome guys. Okay, so yesterday we stopped at the point where we tried to create where we created our application load balancer. And today we will start at a point where we are going to add the auto-scaling group in the front of it. So if you remember, we have created this application load balancer, okay? And today agenda is to add this auto-scaling on the top of it so that we don't need to rely on manually creating those EC2 instances, but auto-scaling group will take care of it. And then further down the lane, we are going to create our MySQL database. And I already shared with you guys what are the things which we are going to do it today. But with all this time crunch, I don't know how much we are able to catch it, but I will try my best. So let's get started because I need to reboot my computer because of all those things. So I need to reopen all those sessions. So just bear with me, guys.
So we can hear you.
Okay, thanks, man. So let's start with auto scaling. Okay, so yesterday I just gave you a brief introduction like what exactly is the auto scaling and how it works. So the auto scaling is basically whenever the load increases, the auto scale group is going to take care of adding the instances in the backend. So if you try to go with a literal definition of it, it's auto scaling, like it automatically, which is, it is going to scale up. Okay, so let's say if I have a minimum of two instances defined and I put a rule in the auto scaling group, let's say CPU equal to 80%. Okay, 80%. Okay, and there is a parameter called max in the auto scaling group. Let's say I set it up to 10, and there is something called desired, which is like this much amount of instances I always want. So what auto scaling group will do, whenever the CPU load goes more than 80%, it is going to spin up more instances to fulfill that load. Okay, so I think enough of theory. Let's work on the practical side, how we are going to do that. So let's go to AWS console. Sorry guys, again, I need to log into all these. Okay, cool. So to configure an auto scaling group, you need to go to the EC2. Scroll down, and yesterday when we are creating the load balancer, the first thing we need to create is the target group where the application load balancer is going to route your request. Okay, in case of auto scaling group, you need to start with something called a launch configuration. So for auto scaling, you need to start with the launch configuration. Okay, and what exactly is the launch configuration? So like I told you above, we need to decide like how much is the minimum number of instances our auto scale group is going to create, or the maximum number of instances. Behind the scene, like if you remember that on the second day or the first day, we tried to create our EC2 instance. So when we are trying to create our EC2 instance, we try to give it him a AMI ID. We try to give him a bunch of parameter like a user data. So all those things we are going to specify in this launch configuration. Like whenever the instance boot up, what are the parameters or what are the metadata which is associated with this instance? So let's go back, okay, and click on this launch configuration. Okay, and you will say create launch configuration. Okay, and so far we have used the CentOS AMI. So let's search for that CentOS 7 AMI in the AWS marketplace. Click on it. Okay. I will start with the general purpose. Okay. Here you can give your launch configuration some name. So let's say I am giving it a my test launch config. Okay. I am not going to talk much about this launch spot instances because in AWS, okay, or let me give you just brief introduction. So in AWS, we have a different kind of instance family. One is called on demand, which most of the people use. So it depends upon the per hour. So the number of hour you are going to use an instance, AWS is going to charge based on that. Second family is called reserve instance. Reserve instance is like where you are buying something for a minimum commitment of 1 or 3 years. And here you are going to get a discount of 70%. At least 70%. So on demand, you are paying per hour. But here in a case of a reserve instances, you are paying AWS upfront cost of 1 year. Okay, that is you are reserving that instance. So in case of on demand, you are not reserving that instance. So for example, let's say I am going to create my instance in R4.16x large. In R4.16x large, there might be a possibility that that instance is at that time of time is not available in AWS. I mean, the physical instance or the instance behind the scene is not present. That is, AWS is run out of capacity at that time. But in reserve instances, you always get your instance. Okay. The third instance family is called spot instance. It's like a bidding. So let's say if I am trying to purchase an instance, okay? So if you go to this AWS instance price, okay? So basically every instance associated with the AWS world is having some price per hour, for example, in on demand. So if you are going to have this A1 medium, you need to pay $0.255 per hour to AWS. Okay, but in case of spot instance, let's say I pick any of this instance. Okay, one second. Let's say I pick this one, M4.5x large. Okay, and for that, the per hour charge is 0.0768 per hour. So in case of a spot instance, I can place a bid of, let's say, 0.500 dollar. Okay, I can even place a bid. So the moment that bid hits, so this is basically an unused capacity in AWS environment. So I can bid for that. But the problem with this approach is that the moment my bid over, when somebody overbids my bid, like let's say somebody overbids with 510. So AWS is going to take out that instance. AWS is basically going to shut this instance. So this is definitely not for production use. It's some kind of a data processing task or the task which can be interrupted easily. For those instances, you can use that spot instance. And the last one is the dedicated instance. So here in all these cases, on-demand, reserve, spot instances, basically you are getting a virtual machine behind the scene. But if you need a physical machine, let's say you are using some software or application which is like a license dependent, like if you know Oracle or all those application, they used to work on the physical machine and they have some license dependency. So for those cases, we need to use this dedicated instance. Okay, I think I have gone enough about it. Purchasing option, so I'm not taking this request spot instance, that is, I'm not bidding for that. I will go with the on demand. IAM role, let's not worry about it at this stage. And enhanced monitoring, let's not worry about it. Enhanced monitoring is basically the monitoring which you are getting for your EC2 instance is every 5 minutes. But when you're going to tick this enable CloudWatch detailed monitoring, in this case, CloudWatch is going to capture your metrics every 1 minute. Okay. But you need to pay extra to AWS for that. Okay, so it comes with some cost. And then some advanced detail. So kernel ID, RAM disk ID, this is something, don't worry about it at this stage. In user data, let's try to create the script which we have created earlier, which is this bin bash. Okay, then I am trying to install Apache. And let's say again, this is coming from Terraform, where www.html, index.html, service httpd start, and chk config httpd on. Okay. So basically what I'm trying to do, like when my instance boots up, it will install Apache. It will have this page. I will try to start this Apache daemon. And once it's been started, after reboot, that application will come back. Okay. And this option is really important because in this case, I'm not launching this instance on a default VPC. I will try to boot this instance on my own created VPC. So that's why I'm choosing option assign a public IP address to every instance, not with a default VPC. But I may deleted my default VPC just to save some cost. So this might change. Let's not worry about storage. Let's go with the default storage option. Okay. And here we can create a new security group. So let's say this is for my launch config. Okay. And because I'm trying to boot Apache, let's add HTTP behind it. Okay. I mean, let's try open HTTP port for the inbound connection. Review and create launch configuration. So it will ask for a key and I think create a new key pair, launch config key pair, config KP. Okay. I'm now downloading the private part of the key and create launch configuration. So this created my launch configuration. That is the configuration which is being used by the EC2 instances or by the instances when they boots up using the auto scaling group. Okay, we can even view that. So this is what we have created. Okay, we can go back. I don't know if we can go back. Okay, but let's create an auto scaling group out of this. So I will say my test auto scale. So using that launch configuration, I'm now creating my auto scaling group where it is already picked this launch configuration. And here I told you we can start with a minimum value. So let's say I'm starting with two instances. Okay. And here is the VPC that we have created yesterday. So let's say my test VPC, and I'm going to choose two public subnet because this is my front end servers. So if you go back here, here. So basically this is behind these servers. So for example, these are my public subnet where I want to put my front end instances. So that's why I'm choosing these public subnet. Okay. For the time being, let's not worry about all these advanced options. If we got some time, I will talk about how this monitoring and health grace period instance protection work. Okay. This create auto scaling group, keep this group at the initial size. That is start with the two instances. Okay. We do not have the time to talk about this scaling policy, but like I told you, if there's one feature of AWS I really like, that is auto scaling group. So if you want to talk more about it, just ping me. I can speak about it like day in and day out. So basically, just to give you a brief idea, here we can define a scale out or scale in policy. So scale out means here I can define, like I told you guys earlier, when the target value of CPU utilization goes more than, or you can define it like this. So here I'm defining, so let's say 2 to 4. So I can define an alarm where I can define if my CPU utilization goes more than 70% for at least for one interval in a 5 minute, let's scale up 2 to 4 instances. Okay. Same way, I can define an alarm where I can define less than equal to 40%. So if my CPU utilization now goes less than 40%, I can decrease those number of instances. So you can see I can define, okay, remove one instance at a time. Okay, or even I can define the percent of groups. So this is basically a scale in and scale out policy we have discussed yesterday. Scale out means we are adding more instances to cope up that load. Scale in means we are taking out those instances because that load is now gone. Okay, so for the time being, let's keep this group at the initial size, that is 2. Next is configure notification. So basically, this is what we are trying to integrate into something called SNS. If you guys are aware of service called SNS, which is called Simple Notification Service. Okay, so what we are trying to do is, like, whenever this kind of operation happens, for example, my CPU utilization goes more than 70%, and we want that will trigger a notification. Notification means, let's say we have configured SNS with the email. Okay, so we will get an email that now my auto scaling group is trying to add few instances behind my load balancer or whatever it is. Okay, we can configure tags, review, and create auto scaling group. Okay, so basically, I know what is the issue. So in the test launch configuration, the security group we have created, and here in auto scaling group, the VPC we have choose is different. Okay, so that's why it's failed. There's one more thing to tell you guys based on this, like, we cannot edit the launch template. The only way we can do it is to copy it. So this will going to create a new launch template. So let's say my new launch config hyphen test, create an auto scaling group using this template. Yes. Here I again need to, okay, wait. Fake new. Okay, create a launch template. Okay, I'm not aware. It's not. Or we can do one thing. Let's delete this and let's create a new one. Okay, my test launch config. Advanced detail. Sorry guys, we need to write that script one more time. Okay, yum hyphen y install stpd go terraform. Let's make it small. Assign public IP address. Okay, this time I will go fast. This one. Okay, here is the important thing. Create a security group. So we can use an existing security group, which is my launch config one, but that is created in VPC 7, this one. So let's take a note of this. This one, review, create launch configuration. Okay, I acknowledge. Create an auto scaling group. My test auto scale start with 2. And this time, let's choose that VPC, which is end with 55801. Okay, 55801. Let's choose those two subnet, 2A and 2B. Anyway, we are going to terraform it, so don't worry about it if you do not understand all these things. Keep this as the initial group, configure notification, we don't want to do that, review and create. Okay, so this time it created our auto scaling group. Last time the security group and the VPC is completely different, so that's why it's failed. Now if you go to the activity history, you will see that because we set up the initial size to 2, so it will automatically start creating those instances for us. Okay, so I know this is too much to digest, so let me wait for 1 minute and I will answer any of your questions. Okay, so the first question is, need your help in understanding the new vCPU based EC2 limit. Madhu, even I need to understand this. I haven't gone through it, but I will go through it and let you know. If I reserve one of the instance for this year, but this, so for Ashok, there is a special reserve instance type. For, let me find it for you, instances. So there is something called a reserve instance, which I have told you right now. But in even in reserve instances, there is something called, I'm not getting that name right now. Instance overview. One second. Types of reserve instances. Yeah, there's a special reserve instances called convertible reserve instances. So like I told you earlier that in reserve instances type, what AWS said that you're going to get a discount of 70%. But if you go with this convertible reserve instances, you will get a discount of let's say 40 or 50%. But in this case, like you said, for example, if you choose R4.8x large, okay, and then you realize, okay, now your load is high and you cannot scale horizontally, you only can scale vertically, and you want to go with the like say R4.16x large. So with this convertible reserve instances, you can go with that family. But in if you start with the standard reserve, no, you cannot. But you can always sell your instances in AWS Marketplace. Okay, so let me forward you this link. Okay, so Kannan, I'm coming to this point now. Okay, so if there's no more question, let me start the Terraform code. So whatever we have done so far with the help of a UI, let's try to create a Terraform code out of it. So for that, let me open my PyCharm. Sorry guys, I have everything open earlier, but due to that hiccup, I need to close all those. Okay, and we have this PyCharm. Okay, so let me close all those things to just do. So if you remember that yesterday we stopped at the point where we have created this ALB module. Okay, now let's go back to the Kannan question. When we hit Terraform apply, where does this code execution start? So basically, if you go here, let me show you something. This guy, I think, where is that? Meetup, Terraform, testing. Yep. So Terraform internally use something called Terraform graph. Let me increase the font size so that you guys can see. Okay, this should be. So basically it build all these graph for you. And let me show you this. Terraform graph. I think it's called WebViz or something like that. Terraform graph visualization. Okay. Graph viewer. Yeah, visualizer, whatever it is. I used to use it heavily, but command graph. Means you can even build it like this, but I want to show you. One second, guys. I think it's called Graph Viz. Yes, this is the one. But I don't know if this is the one. Yep. So let me copy paste that code and generate a graph. I don't know if you guys can see this, but let me try to. So the short answer of this, Terraform read this code from top to bottom, but Terraform is smart enough to figure out all these dependencies for you. So it internally build this graph and it will know. So for example, if you want to create an EC2 instance, you need this subnet, right? And these subnets are coming from VPC. So Terraform internally know with the help of this graph, okay, this resource need to be created first before triggering this resource. So what does that mean? So if I put this module first on the top of the list, if I stack it like this, Terraform is smart enough to know that it need to create this VPC first before triggering out the EC2. Okay, so is that answer your question? That how this whole thing works internally? So basically it created this graph for you. And if you want, wherever you are running that Terraform code, let me give you that command so that you can create it by yourself, because this is a Linux machine, so I don't have this graph is installed, otherwise I can show you. So basically try to run this command and see how your Terraform is like building that dependency. And try to open this PNG file. You will see the same graph similar to like this, which I have created earlier. Okay, so with that said, let's move further. And before that, let me increase the font size of this. Okay, so guys, we don't have much time. We only have like 28 minutes left or 18 minutes left. So let me quickly go through this auto scaling group code. Yep, Alexander. Is it fine? Okay. And before we go to that auto scaling code, let me show you one more thing before I forget. And today is like a bad day. So, 9, 3. Okay, so we have created that auto scaling configuration. In that auto scaling configuration, we have defined that we need to spin up these two instances. If you go to the details and edit, okay, if you come here we just need to define that my target group, which we have created for application load balancer. Okay, so I don't know if we still have that target group available. I think I have deleted it. I don't know. Yeah, we have that. So this is a target group which we have created for application load balancer. So in this auto scaling group configuration, now I just need to specify this my target group. What this is going to do is now my auto scaling group will depend upon the health check of application load balancer. Okay. So if you remember this picture, this guy. So now what this is going to do, application load balancer is going to check the health of these EC2 instances. Yesterday we have defined that health check. Here in load balancer. Okay, I do not have that load balancer, I think. Yeah, health check. So we have defined this health check. Yesterday I told you like how it's going to perform the health check. So now this application load, this guy, my auto scaling group will depend upon the application load balancer health check. And it is going to spun these instances behind the scene if any of this health check fail. So let's say this instance is not behaving properly. So what this is going to do, my auto scaling group will depend upon the health check of this application load balancer and is going to spun one instances for me. Okay. If you want to see this, let's go to auto scaling group or let's go here. Okay. So this is created by auto scaling group. Let me try to kill one of these instances. So let's terminate it. Okay. The only problem is because we have specified the health check of 30 seconds, so we need to wait 1.5 minutes. Okay. So let's wait, not wait for that. I will come back to the screen one more time, but we will see that this has been terminated and auto scaling group by default is going to spun up that instances for me. So this feature is pretty cool. Like you don't even need to worry about if the instances are coming or means if my instance is healthy or if it's not responding properly, auto scaling group is going to take care of that. And the only thing you need to do is modify your configuration to point it out to that auto, to that target group, this target group, which you have created for application load balancer. Okay. So now coming back to this Terraform code, this is pretty simple. Okay. This looks complex, all these like concept and everything, but the Terraform code part is pretty straightforward. So what exactly you need to do is you need to define the launch configuration. Okay. So if you go back here, if you remember, the first thing we have defined for auto scaling group is the launch configuration, where we have defined all those parameters. So for example, the AMI ID, the key name, the instance type. So same thing we need to define with the help of Terraform code. So here I'm using a resource called AWS launch configuration, and then I'm giving it a name of this. After that, I'm specifying the image ID, okay, the instance type, and I am creating a security group here. You can use the existing security group, but I have created a security group where I have opened port 22 and port 80, and I'm opening all the outbound port. Okay. Actually, I need to modify this code because now everything is controlled by auto scaling group and application load balancer. We might not need to log into to those instances, but this is completely up to you. Okay. Then the same thing I defined is called user data, where I'm defining, okay, the same thing, like install the Apache, put this file in index.html, started. This is something new for you guys, lifecycle create before you destroy. This is important. So let me try to explain to you guys what exactly this lifecycle Terraform. Okay. Or lifecycle. I don't know where is that, but let me try to explain it to you guys into the simple terms. So far, we are creating all those instances using Terraform, using the Terraform EC2 module, right? EC2 module. We have defined over there, okay, create the when we set count equal to 2, Terraform is behind the scene, is creating two instances for us. But now we have moved to this ALB part, application load balancing and auto scaling. Okay. And there we have defined this scale out and scale in policy. Okay. Where scale out is like, okay, if the load of the CPU increased to more than 90%, add two more instances. And if it goes less than 50%, terminate two instances. So everything is happening behind the scene automatically without our control once we set up this configuration. So what lifecycle will do, so let's say I want to terminate or add two more instances to it. So what lifecycle will do, it's just a check on the top of it that before you are going to destroy any instances, make sure that we have the sufficient instances in our auto scaling group. Okay, so it's a kind of a check that don't delete anything before creating a new one. Does that make any sense? Okay. So this is just a rule, means just a prevention check. After that, I specify a resource called auto scaling group with the name of this variable, and I'm referring back to this launch configuration. This launch configuration, AWS launch configuration, then the variable name, my test launch config, and then the name. Then I specify the VPC. We already saw that whenever we choose the wrong VPC, whatever the error we are getting. And then the target group ARN. This ARN is coming from the load balancer. So if you remember that, here in the auto scaling group, we have choose this target group ARN. Okay, and because we are in this page, let's see if it's created the new instance for us. Yeah, so because we have terminated, it started forking the new instance for us. Okay, and even you can check this here. So if you go to auto scaling group, you can check the this. We can debug this why this is failed, but these are all the earlier one, but it terminated and start creating a new instances. Okay, let's go back to our code. Then the health check is the ELB. Now, because we have specified this target group ARN, that is the ALB ARN, we are depending upon the health check of ELB. By default, it's the EC2. Okay, here we are specifying the minimum number of instances to start and the maximum number to start. And then we are specifying the a bunch of tags to it. So this is like pretty straightforward. Okay, now just want to talk one more minute regarding this before we will move out to our next topic, which is RDS. Is that auto scaling group seems to be a fancy concept where everything works, but it is little bit more complex, or it is much more complicated than whatever we can, like I thought that whenever I when the first time I was working on this auto scaling group, I thought that okay, if I set this up, I don't need to worry about my infrastructure, everything works perfectly fine. But for example, in this case, I just show you a hello world example, but in your production environment, you have a application which is a kind of, for example, in your case, it might be a custom application or something which is much more complex than that. So based on my experience, auto scaling group works perfectly fine for the stateless application. But in a case of a stateful application, you need to do a bunch of changes. So if you guys are aware of this concept called stateful versus stateless application. So in case of a stateless application, you don't need to worry about the sessions. So for example, I have this application load balancer and bunch of EC2 instances. EC2 instance 1, EC2 instance 2. I mean, let's say I have like 100 of EC2 instances running here. So if my instances is going to be terminate, let's say this auto scaling group is trying to kill this instance and spinning up one new instances for me. So I am not worried about the session which has been created between this application load balancer and this EC2 instance. This application load balancer, when our user is trying to hit this instance, and if this instance is no longer responding, application load balancer will move this traffic to the new instance or the existing, any of the existing instance. But in case of a stateful application, if this kind of a thing happen, then user will see that the page not found or all those kind of a error. Okay, so in case of a stateful application, you need to do some more amount of work when configuring this auto scaling group. Just to make things more complex, you always need to, like the one thing which is just based on my experience, is you need to worry about this policy called termination policy. So I gave you the example of this, like when the scaling happen, auto scaling group is going to terminate two instances just to reduce your cost. But which two instances are going to pick up? That is the most tricky part. So for that, we have like a bunch of policies, like the oldest instance first, newest instance, all these things. So if you do not know about all these things, just go with the default option. Okay, same way is the instance protection. If you don't want that in the particular instance to be terminated, you can put this instance protection here. Okay. So just going to give you this, all these idea, like how this, all these things works, but try to use this feature. This is pretty good and it will make your life pretty much easy. You're going to implement this feature. Okay, with that said, let me wait again for 60 seconds. And if you have guys have any question, I will try to answer those. Yeah, Prashant, I think I explained a little bit about the stateful versus stateless. So Ashok Reddy, this is what we are used to do in a case of a blue-green deployment. Like whenever I want to deploy some new configuration, I always build a new AMI and a new launch configuration and deploy 50% of the node using that launch new configuration, or depending upon your requirement, 80-20 or 90-10. So only way you can do it is to create a new launch configuration, because you cannot modify the existing launch configuration. Yeah, Kanan, that's a pretty complicated topic. So in those cases, for example, based on my experience, what we are doing in our, my company, is we are storing all those sessions in a Redis. Okay, but it cannot be explained in 1 minute or just in 1 hour topic, but it's pretty complicated in a case of a those stateful application. So short answer is we are storing all those sessions in Redis database. Or if you are using Memcache, you can store it over there. Any other question? Yes, Laila. DB is a good example for stateful application. Or any application we stored your session. So simplest example is, for example, if you have an account in Bank of America and if you are trying to log in, and you are seeing your account page where you are seeing all your balances. So that is one stateful application which has been set up to your backend server. Now, if that server has been terminated by AutoScaling group, then that session will be lost. So you need some way to store that kind of a session. So the stateful application, stateless application is pretty simple. So if that instance will be terminated, you can just move that session, or application load balancer or any kind of a load balancer will take care of moving those session to some other server. Okay. And I haven't spoke about a sticky session. Even in case of a stateless application, you can create a sticky session so that your request is always going to hit to a one particular server. But those are all those concepts which I'm again saying we cannot, I cannot explain that in 1 hour session. I mean, we spend hours and hours to try to figure it out how we can going to take care of this stateful application. I mostly sit with my developers and try to figure it out how we are going to save those sessions in Redis. So if you need more information, just ping me. But sorry guys, we are running out of time today. So if there's no other question, let me move to our second topic called RDS. It's already 8:59 PST, so this session might extend to 9:15 if you guys are okay. Then we will go over it, and I have something bonus for you guys, because this is going to be the last session for this year. Can you hear me now? My microphone seems to be looks good. Okay, thanks guys. Yeah, so let's move to the RDS part. So AWS provides these bunch of database offering, out of which this Amazon Aurora is their own in-house database, which is built on the top of Postgres as well as the MySQL. But today our focus will be the MySQL database. So this is the one, okay, we are going to use. There are some advantage of using AWS RDS functionality. For example, AWS will going to take care of all the backups. And one of the feature which I really like that they are really being proactive in terms of if there any new patch comes. So it can be any minor upgrade or major upgrade, they are going to inform you in advance that they are going to perform it. Okay, so you don't need to worry about all those things when you're going to use this MySQL service or AWS RDS service. So out of that, here you're going to choose the MySQL version, that this is the version you're going to boot. Which services are free? So yes, so that we will come right now, Abdul. So here you have three templates. So one is production, one is dev test, and one is free tier. So we will start with this free tier, and then we will make going to make this as a productionized database. So now free tier, let's see what are the limitations of those free tier. I will say database identifier, my test, MySQL RDS. So what is this? Is just on the an identifier. So when you will go to this, once this database will be created, if you go to the AWS console, this will be the identifier. So let's say if you have a 10 database, so and out of which you want to identify which is your which database you have created, this is just an identification mark, or you can think of it like a tag. Okay, then you are going to set up your username. Here it is admin, and let me put up any password, admin123. Okay, then because this is coming under free tier, I can only go up to the T2 micro instance. Okay, same way, because it's a free tier, I can only use general purpose SSD with 20 GB as a allocated storage. Okay, and if you go above this, like 30 GB, you need to pay extra. That will not come under your free tier. Then this is a feature called enable storage auto-scaling. This is something new which has been introduced by AWS. So for example, if your 20 GB is full, then AWS automatically without any downtime is going to increase your database. Okay. Here is some of the limitation of the free tier, that you cannot deploy multi-AZ. So what exactly is this multi-AZ deployment? Multi-AZ deployment. So in this case, what AWS is going to do is, depending upon the VPC you choose, it's going to spin up one MySQL DB for you in one of the availability zones. So let's say I choose US West 2. So out of the different availability zones available in that US West 2 region, it's just going to spin up that instance or the MySQL database in one of the availability zones. Let's say it picks US West 2A. But if we choose any of the other offering which are paid, for example, dev test or production, what AWS is going to do, it's going to spin up one instance in the primary, as a primary in one of the availability zone, let's say US West 2A, and then it's going to create a replica, let's say in US West 2B. Okay. So that is multi-AZ deployment. That is, your database is going to deploy in multiple availability zone. Availability zone, not region. If you need your database to be in the multiple region, then there is a concept of called read replica. Let me copy this. there's a concept of called read replica. So if you think of your application or most of the applications which are available on the internet, they are read heavy. Okay. Most of the time you are reading some content out of it, and rarely or in lesser amount of time you are writing a concept on the top of you are writing any data to it. So just to take that kind of a load, you can create a read replica, that is, which can only be used to fetch the data from your database. Okay, so let's take a simple example of a let's say in your company you have some business analyst whose function is to find it out which which product is on the top of the sale list. So what he needs to do, he or she just need to go to run some query to find it out what thing is in the top of that list, like which product is the top seller for this month. So he don't need to write any data on your database. So for that kind of a cases, we can use this read replica, and this read replica you can spun up in any region, not in specific availability zone. So if I choose US West 2, which is Oregon, this primary and replica can only be created in the same region. But this read replica, I can spun up in the North Virginia. And what this read replica is a read-only copy of my primary database with some replication lag. So this is not the exact copy, this read replica. Even in between the primary and secondary or the replica, there is some replication lag, but that is minimal as compared to this read replica. Okay, let's move further. So here we are defining our VPC. Okay, in which VPC we want this RDS to be created. Okay, additional connectivity option, I can choose a default subnet group, publicly accessible. You guys know that we don't want our database to be publicly accessible, so it's no. VPC security group, make sure if you don't want to go with the default VPC, whatever VPC you are going to create, depending upon your database type, make sure its port is open. So for example, MySQL, the default port is 3306. So let's open that port. Password authentication, you can integrate your database with the IAM. Honestly, I never tried that, but you can do that. Let's go with the initial configuration. So here you are going to specify your actual database name. So the first thing we have defined earlier is just a kind of a tag. But here we are defining our actual database name. So my test RDS, okay. These are all these parameter group, which I never touched it. Here you can define the enable automatic backup. So that's what the one thing which I liked about AWS, that I don't need to worry about taking this backup because AWS will automatically take care of it. One thing which you need to pay attention, that the maximum backup retention period is 35 days. So after 35 days, if you want your backup to be more than 35 days, you need to take care of all those snapshots. So if you guys, let me take just 1 minute to understand, to give you guys the idea of snapshot. So let's say I created this RDS database whose EBS volume is 20 GB in size, right? And initially I put 1 GB of data on the top of it. So first day when AWS is going to take a snapshot of it, it's 1 GB, right? Let's say the next day you put 100 MB of data on the top of this 1 GB. So it's now 1 GB plus 100 MB. So next day your snapshot which will be created is not 1.1 or 1.100 MB, whatever it is. It's only be a 100 MB of snapshot. Okay. So in case if you want your backup retention period, so behind the scenes backup is just a snapshot of your database. So if you want your backup to be more than 35 days, okay, you need to take the snapshot to some, you need to move that snapshot to some other location. So in my case, we already wrote some of the lambda function to take care of this. By default, AWS does not provide this functionality. But just to be remember that if on 35 day, after 35 day, if your snapshot will be removed, the next snapshot will be, which will be created, is will be the snapshot of your entire database. Okay, so you got that point. So once again, if it's 1 GB, so first day it will be a complete snapshot. After that, it's just going to be a incremental snapshot, not the complete snapshot. Okay. You can define your own backup window at what time you want that backup to be started. I usually put it like 1 a.m. or 2 a.m. in the night, but just to give you this example, we can enable the enhanced monitoring, but for that, like by default, like with any AWS service, your monitoring is for every 5 minutes. But if you enable this, it will even go to a granularity level of 60 seconds. But that is extra. Here, this is one important thing which I have told you earlier, enable auto miner upgrade. So let's say you are running 5.7.21 version of MySQL database. And tomorrow, let's say 5.7.2 version came in. So AWS will automatically take care of upgrading the database on your behalf. Okay, and you can always select this window, like when you want AWS to implement those version upgrade. I usually put this on the Sunday night or Saturday night, between the 1 a.m. or 2 a.m. in the night, but it's completely depend upon your requirement. And finally, with all those things in place, we can create our database. Okay, so now you can see that AWS is creating that database for us, and it will at least take 10 to 15 minutes. So in the meanwhile, we can go to the Terraform code. And Terraform code of this database, of creating MySQL database, is pretty straightforward. Okay, so first thing is you need to define a resource called is AWS DB instance, and you can give any identifier. Instance class is similar to that, but remember that for database we have a different instance family. So I can show you here AWS DB instance. So if you remember, for your normal instances, you have something t2.micro or m4 or whatever it is. But here we have something called db.m5 or db.something. So with that means for all these databases, the instance family start with that this DB extension. And even if you can go here and click on this, okay, still creating, I just want to show you. See, so instance class which we have choose is not t2.micro, it's something called db.t2.micro. Okay, so just remember this point. Engine type is MySQL, but you can choose Oracle. So let me show you this engine_type. Okay, so engine, yep, and we need to see this API. So here you can choose all these options, for example Amazon Aurora, MySQL, MariaDB, whatever I have shown you earlier on the screen on the UI. Okay, multi AZ is equal to true. So this is one thing which I have showed you earlier. Currently, the database which we are creating is just going to create our database in a single AZ. But if you want your database to be like primary and replica, then you need to put this as a true. Then this is simple. Storage type is GP2. Allocated storage is 20. Or you can put it as like IO1 or whatever be your requirement. Here we can give our database a name. Okay, the username through which you are going to log into this database, and this password. So if you read my blog, I'm still working on this part, because this is a bad practice to store our database password in a plain text. So if you go to this code, I don't know if I checked in that code. So here we have a resource called data resource through which you can encrypt this password. but there's a bug in that Terraform.0.12. I'm still working on that. So I will push that code as soon as I found the solution for that. Apply immediately. This feature I need to show you. I don't know if we can get a time to show this feature. Backup retention period is 10 days. Like I showed you, it's from 1 to 35 days. Backup window, you can define it. Where you want your database to be, where you want your database instance to be located. Here you can define the subnet group. And finally, the security group ID. So this is pretty simple code. I already checked in this code to GitHub. So if you guys have any question, you can check it over here or ping me, but it is pretty straightforward. How major version upgrade will happen? So Ashok, I can tell you based on my experience. So in my company, we have a TAM associated with us. So TAM generally inform us like 3 months ahead that AWS is planning to implement this major database upgrade. Or unless or until there is some critical security bug which comes in that particular database family. So in that case, we need to patch our database obviously immediately. But for any major upgrade which AWS is planning, they are at least informing us 2 to 3 months ahead. Once we have a read replica, all the read will automatically go to no. So for read replica, let me show you one thing. Okay. Actually, this is still creating. So let me show you the one which we have, I have created last night. Okay. So this is the end point. So once you create this database, you are going to get this endpoint, and using that endpoint, you are going to access your database. So for once you are going to create a read replica, you are going to get a different read endpoint. So that endpoint, you need to give it to your developer or your business analyst or whom you want to share, or if you want to code that in your application. Does that answer your question? Generally, this looks weird. So what we used to do, we go to Route 53 and used to create the CNAME record on the top of it. I do not have any domain registered over here, but to answer your question, for a read replica, you are going to get a different endpoint. Okay. What is the use of parameter group and option group? How about primary replica? Yeah, so I don't know if I... So if you go here, I don't know if I've created this with the multi-AZ, yes. So this is multi-AZ, if you see, okay? And our primary, where is our primary? This is the one. So if you can see here, our secondary is located in US West 2A, and primary is in US West 2B, okay? So let me show you something. If I'm going to reboot this, okay, I can do something called reboot with failover. Okay, and the best way to check this, as you can see, it's rebooting, but the way I used to check it here is, sometimes it will take some time to get it reflected here. Okay, it's still not showing up. Okay, yeah, so it's showing DB instance restarted. Maybe it's today or where? Yeah. Okay, so I think this is taking some time, but let me go back to the main idea which you are asking. So you're always going to access this endpoint, this one. Come here. Okay. Or whatever the CNAME record you have you created out of it. So right now, like I showed you, this is in US West 2A. Okay. US West 2B. and your secondary or the replica is in US West 2A. But at the time, only one is up and running. I mean, that is in replicated mode. You cannot access that replica. When the failover happen, like the way we have done the failover, what AWS will do is automatically going to update this endpoint. Like it's just going to point this endpoint to US West 2A. You don't need to do anything. Is that answer your question? So to answer your question in the simplest sense, you cannot access read replica. You always going to not read replica. You cannot access the replica. You always going to access the primary endpoint. And whenever the failover happen, what AWS is going to do is going to keep the same endpoint. It's just going to switch behind the scene, pointing it to the US West 2A. Okay. Guys, I know we are like, it's 9:22. So let's stop at this point. But before I'm going to end this session, like I told you guys, this is the last session for this year. So I just want to give you guys few pointers. If you want to if you want to learn more about Terraform, these are some good resources. So one is called Terraform Up and Running Book. I already mentioned this in the Slack channel, but this is a pretty good book. And this is the first place where I started like 2 years back when I started my Terraform journey. So this is one. Let me bring you guys here as well as in the Slack channel. Okay. The second resource from where you can explore more of our Terraform code is called Terraform Registry. So whatever the modules we are building so far, people already contributed all these modules for you. For example, the VPC module. And the way you can use this module is just copying this code and change it according to your requirement. So for example, if you want to create this in US West 2, or you just need to modify these parameters. And the third resource, let me ping you guys this one also, this Terraform Registry. And last but not the least is something called Console Recorder. I think I already mentioned all these things in that Slack channel. So Console Recorder for AWS. So let me show you how this thing works. So basically, this is just a Chrome extension, which you need to enable it. I already enabled that Chrome extension. So now, let's take a simple example. I want to create one EC2 instance. So let me click here, Console Recorder for AWS, and start recording. Once you enable that, it's going to show you this icon on the top right corner, EC2. Okay, let me launch an instance. Launch instance. Select. Right now, I'm just showing you how that console recorder works. So I can choose any of these configuration. Anything. Add storage. Add tag. Review and launch. Launch. Okay. I can choose any of these key. Go back to your console recorder. Click here. Stop recording. Okay. It will automatically generate that Terraform code for you. So whatever we are doing it manually over here, like this, it will pick. So if you guys are aware of something called Selenium for testing, this is similar to Selenium for this AWS, where it will capturing all your API calls. But as you can see, this is not perfect. Like it's only captured the security group and AWS instance. And it's not your complete Terraform code. So you need to modify your Terraform code after capturing this via this console recorder. So just want to throw this idea so that in case if you like this, or at least you have some code available for you, and then you can build on the top of it. And the good thing about the console recorder that it not only captures the Terraform API calls, but also this Porto 3, CloudFormation, and this AWS CLI. I am not aware of all the other this troposphere, but at least it will give you some idea like how behind the scene, how this API call works. Okay, so something of food for thought. You can use this feature called console recorder. It's pretty handy, but it is not perfect. Okay, so